Would you like to know what does a security architect do, or what does a cloud security architect do? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name's Mike Gibbs, and I've been an IT architect now for a little over 25 years, and I've loved every last minute of it. I've trained architects that work at every organization you can possibly imagine, and in this video, we're going to talk about what does a security architect do. Now, I have to tell you, the security architect, the enterprise architect, the cloud architect, they're among the best jobs in the world. They're both high-paying, and we can't be replaced by AI, which I'll talk a lot about in a little bit. So what is the average pay for the security architect? Well, it's approximately $229,000 a year, according to Glassdoor, with a range of, say, $183,000 to $292,000 per year. But that feels a little low to me, but they are Glassdoor numbers, so they're going to be averages. And I can tell you the security architect career is very unlike other careers like software engineering. Architects cannot be replaced by AI because AI cannot do the human-to-human work, which is most of the job of the security architect and the cloud security architect. And why am I bundling the security architect and the cloud security architect roles together? Because at this point, most organizations have a data center and multiple clouds that are out there. So no matter which our focus is, we're always going to be working in the cloud and the data center as any kind of security architect, cloud architect, or cloud security architect. And the cloud security architect could be working on private clouds too, as can the security architect of private clouds like OpenStack or Nutanix, which are very common. Now, I want to tell you right now that the security architect is not a hands-on role. We don't touch the technology. We don't configure firewalls, IDS, IPS systems, SIEM systems. We don't touch identity and access management systems, data loss prevention systems, hands-on. We are a hybrid professional that is a technology professional and a business executive in the same person. So let's talk about what we do do as security architects. We help an organization manage risk. So what does that really mean? It's about creating a strategic blueprint to protect that organization from harm. We also create security policies in addition to our security architectures, and I'll talk about that. But this blueprint could be a combination of physical security, things like guards and gates, for example. It could be a combination of things to find out what's going wrong. It could be a means of protecting data. It could be a means of segmenting the environment, and we'll talk about what goes into that. But the strategic blueprint are going to be the types of technologies and how the technologies fit together, as well as processes and procedures to protect that organization from harm. So now that you know what we actually do, let's also talk about what is a security policy, because that's also something we create. An organization's security policy is going to be a comprehensive set of rules, guidelines, and procedures to protect that organization, its information, its assets, and its infrastructure from threats. So basically, a company will work with a company to help them create a security policy, its rules, procedures, what have you, and then that will establish the employee expectations and the way employees will behave. It'll outline security measures and even ensure that the company stays legal and complies with regulations. So now that we talked about that, let's talk about what goes into developing a security architecture, because that's going to be the main focus of the job. The first thing the security architect really needs to do to design a security architecture is to determine the organization's level of risk as well as their risk tolerance. So we have to help that organization quantify and calculate their exposure or their risk. Because if we don't know the organization's risk, what do we know what our mitigation procedures are going to be? We can't. So we have to figure out what is their risk. Now, the next thing we need to do is assess that organization's risk tolerance, and we also have to assess the organization's regulatory requirements, because, for example, we might have a bank that has to comply with multiple sets of regulatory requirements. Now, after we understand that organization's risk, and after we understand the legal and regulatory environment, then we can develop a risk mitigation plan. And that's going to be the fun part of our job. This is designing the actual security architecture. So how do we do this as a security architect? Well, we're going to have to create a security architecture team. And in any architecture role, we have to build a team, because when we're dealing with an enterprise customer, for example, we may have a few hundred thousand IP addresses in use, 1,000 applications that are actually in use, petabytes of data that are going to be scattered throughout the world, for example, remote workers and tens or thousands or hundreds of thousands of them. So things get pretty complicated. So we're going to need an entire team. So we're going to first create our architecture team, and they're going to help us baseline or understand what we actually have in the environment. Some of these people will be scanning for vulnerabilities. Some of these people will be looking and mapping out the systems, their capacities, their utilizations, their weaknesses, how their network's laid out, what have you. Now, after we get that and we understand what an organization has, then we can evaluate the current security posture. What is the network security, the identity, what have you? Is it meeting that organization's goals? And will that current architecture and that current technology, blueprint, infrastructure, processing procedures that they have meet the needs of the organization in the future? Or do we find gaps, or do we find security vulnerabilities? What do we need to do after we've done these assessments to figure out what we need to secure that organization? So that's going to be the next phase for us, is creating of a new architecture team. Now, we're going to take the findings of what we have against the goals of the future, and we're going to perform what's called the gap analysis. We're going to say current security state, this is what we need to do in the future, and create a list of gaps. Now, at this point, we're going to create a new architecture team, or use the same architecture team as we had before, potentially. And here we're going to design the new architecture strategy or security blueprint. We're going to find a way to protect that organization from danger. Now, this is going to take a coordinated team, because we're probably going to have at least 10 or 20 security vendors. We're going to have a tremendous number of applications. We're going to have a data center, a cloud. So we're going to be dealing with a lot of complexity here. And we're not going to be able to do this with one person. We're going to need people that have expertise in networking, expertise in identity and access management, which can be an old field by itself. We'll need people with expertise in network security versus application security. So we're going to need a good, strong team here. Now, we're going to create that architecture team. Now, that team is going to design a new plan or a new blueprint. Now, this blueprint will include things like physical security. It will include identity and access management, which is determining who you are, what you're allowed to do, and keeping track of it, for example. And you'll have a team of people that are on that and people with expertise on that. You may also have a zero trust architecture, and you may need some zero trust experts to help you as well. There'll be network security that'll be involved, things like access control lists on routers and switches, firewalls, IDS, IPS systems, QoS, traffic shaping, for example. We'll be doing a lot about encryption and cryptography as security architects. So we'll be thinking about data in movement, data at rest, and all the cryptographic algorithms we might be able to deal with. We'll be thinking a lot about data security. So how do we keep that data secure? How do we make sure the data hasn't been changed, meaning data integrity? We'll be thinking about how do we keep the data from leaving the environments, things like data loss prevention systems. We'll be thinking about data confidentiality, which usually comes from encryption. Then we'll be thinking about application security. For example, when the applications are developed, should there be things like input validation and prevent users from entering funny things that they shouldn't, crashing an application or a server? What about security scaling of the code and application security? We'll have lots of controls there. And there'll be controls on development, like code reviews and security checks for code, for example. Now, we'll also have to work with that organization in the development of detective controls or controls to find things that are going on. And SIEM systems or security event monitoring systems typically help us a lot to aggregate logs from firewalls, routers, switches, what have you. But there's other detective controls like IDS, IPS systems as well, which give us lots of information. We'll be thinking about the systems and their endpoints, for example, the servers themselves and the workstations, for example, and notebooks and mobile devices the employees are using. We'll be building and planning around governance, risk, and compliance. So maybe we've got a healthcare organization that has to respond to, say, HIPAA and meet HIPAA compliance if they're in the United States. So there's more rules and regulations there we have to focus on. And of course, we build business continuity and disaster recovery plans. What happens if there's a hurricane, for example? What would happen if there were a strike? What were to happen if there were a war? What were to happen if there was a giant tsunami? I don't know. But we have to build a plan in order to make sure that business can stay operational and thrive under any kind of adverse conditions, because we have to focus as architects on designing resiliency strategies and protection strategies for the business. Now, after we create this team and we're looking at all these things that we talked about, endpoint detection, detective controls, governance, risk compliance, data security, encryption, what have you, now we take that architecture, that blueprint that we created with that architecture team, and now we've got to go back to key stakeholders at the organization, get their input and tuning. We have to tune that architecture accordingly, because when we're dealing with an enterprise, and in many cases, we security architects and cloud security architects are working in enterprises. In most cases, we actually are, because they need people that are going to pay a security architect typically have big security needs like an enterprise. We will have to assess the impact of our security blueprint on various parts of that organization. And that's why we have to go to the key stakeholders, because we can't break a business just because we want to make it more secure, because that will mitigate the whole point of our security architecture in the first place. It's not protecting an organization from harm if we damage the business with security. So that means we'll have to go to the stakeholders, get their input, tune the architecture, present it back to the stakeholders, and get their buy-in. And at that point, when we've got stakeholder approval and stakeholder buy-in, we typically will finalize the architecture and go with the account team, like the sales rep, potentially the sales engineer that might be with that account, potentially the solutions architect with that account. But now we're there as a security architect, and we'll go present the security architecture to management, help sell it to the CISO, CEO, COO, CIO, so they will purchase or adopt the new security architecture. Now, at that point, we typically create an architecture statement of work, which will include architecture timelines and deployment timelines, the number of people required to deploy it, the type of people required to deploy and maintain the new architecture after it's been built. And then we typically create a governance plan for the implementation. You know, who's going to govern the implementation? Now, some other things we do as security architects is create security policies and incident response procedures. For example, let's say there is a security incident. An incident prompt procedure would say, who's going to speak to the press? Who's going to speak to industry regulators? Who's going to lead the response? And what kind of people are necessary for the incident's response in the first place? So if you can see it and if you can feel it, the security architect job is really going to be a security consulting job. It's going to feel a lot like a strategy consultant. And I can tell you, when I've worked as a management and strategy consultant or an architect, I really can't tell the difference between the jobs, because we're always about designing a blueprint to optimize performance. So we can say the security architect will be meeting with clients. The security architect will be leading teams. The security architect will be facilitating meetings. The security architect will be delivering presentations to executives. The security architect will be managing vendors and stakeholders. The security architect will be involved in selling security architectures. Security architects will create documents and security architecture repositories. And it may be one of the best jobs in the world. So now you know, what does a security architect do, or what does a cloud architect do, or a cloud security architect do? I invite you to this wonderful career. And I can tell you that after 25 years as an architect, I consider it to be one of the best jobs in the world. So join us on a free webinar to learn how to become a cloud security architect. And if you've enjoyed this video, please give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to assist you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I look forward to seeing you in a free webinar or another video.